Right, we're here with Lee Jackson, a phenomenon in carp angling. He's been doing it over 40 years. We're talking about a key edge, which is bait. We just want to know a few sort of thoughts, how Lee sort of breaks down the process and what he uses and why he uses it. So over to you, Lee.
Yeah, well, Steve, how are you doing? Yeah. Well, as you say, I've been at it 40 years and I've lived all through the sort of Fred Wilton age and things like that. So I'm very much still of the same opinion that, you know, bait should be quite a nutritious food source for the fish. And in many ways, I think, you know, a lot of aspects of carp fishing are important, but I think bait sometimes, very often, can be the most important aspect, because, you know, if you get the bait going to the extent that the fish are viewing it as a natural food, I mean, forget location, the fish locate the bait
over,
they want to
game
eat.
Game over, you know? Isn't it? If you're on your game.
That's right. I mean, if you team up with a few lads and keep the bait going irregular, and, you know, it's so much easier to catch them in the first place.
Yeah.
And then, like, there's little sort of edges you can, like, for argument's sake, I mean, for a lot of my fishing, I use a snowman approach. In normal circumstances, most guys, with, you know, whatever bottom bait they'd be using, they'd use the same sort of pop-up on the top. Where I don't. I tend to use what I consider a real eye-attract pop-up.
Yeah.
You know, tried and tested, caught loads of fish on, over the top of a bottom bait. And that, in my view, gives you the best of both worlds, you know?
I just want to take you back, though, Lee, because you say you use a double bait, and there'll be a reason for that. Lee Jackson will have a reason why you use it, and why does it make it so different than a single bait?
I mean, you've got to remember, fish haven't got hands, have they?
No.
They can't. I mean, we feel things with our hands. Fish can only suck it in their mouth, and to my view, it's a different feeling in the carp's mouth. You know, two baits as opposed to one bait, you know? Or even, I've used three baits, four baits. Mm. I mean, Alan said about his shantercock bit that he was using, like, 3 24mm on air, like, you know? And I do it really just to be a little bit, you know, different to what the normal guy's using.
Yeah.
I mean, if the majority of blokes on the lake are using sort of 18mm bottom baits or whatever, I'll use 2 18s or 3 pop-ups or whatever.
Yeah, 2 10mm or whatever.
Yeah, and it's certainly, I mean, when I was first sort of doing it years ago, I used to think it was down to the greed factor, but I don't think it is. I think it's more to the, you know, point of view, the carp sucks up the bait and it's a different feeling in its mouth it can't deal with.
I mean, a few years back, I developed a little fluorocarbon rig. I noticed you're using fluorocarbon, and what I was doing, very similar to this, but I was actually boring out a hole through the bottom bait.
Oh, right.
And what was happening, the bottom bait would sit down like so.
Yeah.
It actually slid down, that's on there tight, and it would actually, on the bottom, it would cover the hook and leave a gap. And I actually annihilated Wellington Country Park on that. Really, really did work well. You have to make sure you put a knot in the pop-up and not in
that's
the...
That's right, yeah.
And,
yeah.
And that used to slide up and down. And I think when they sucked that in, that created such a problem, because the two baits went in as one. When they blew it, the bottom bait,
they
literally,
they
separate.
Yeah.
And
it
would cause an absolute headache for
the car. That's right. It's the same, I mean, when you're using two heavy bottom baits, like 18mm bottom baits, I mean, it sucks it in and they immediately fall to the bottom of the carp's mouth and the hook goes in, you know, in the bottom lip. No problem. And
I noticed you got a few little extra bits in that boilie on the bottom there.
Yeah, I mean, these are sort of homemade boilies. Always like, obviously you can't do it with ready-made boilies, but always make, if I have my bait made up for me or make them myself, always include the eggshells.
Yeah.
I mean, years ago we used to pick the eggshells out, like you couldn't have an eggshell in the bait, but I really do think it adds a little edge. Like, it's a little bit of a crunch factor. It's like using the tiger nuts. I mean, tiger nuts, in my view, are effective because of that crunch factor.
Yeah.
Same as hemp, you know. So I think including the eggshells in the mix does.
I was just interested because I used to do that years ago. Put it in the mix, and I put it nowadays. I actually put it in the, if I make any bait, I'll keep the eggshells.
Yeah.
Put them in the microwave 30 seconds.
Right.
Crunch them up. They go tiny little pieces.
Yeah.
And put them in your spod mix.
Yeah.
If you chew a little bit, you can hear it through all your bones.
And I think the
noise traveling underwater. This is why you get big hits. With eggshell in the bait. You know, I just noticed you don't see many people using that.
No, that's right. I mean, another thing people use is oyster shell grit.
Yeah,
you know, they use that. It makes the bait ever so heavy as well.
I think they've been using that in like the stick mixes.
Yeah, that's right. But I think all these little things are just little edges that, as I say, you know, the way noise travels underwater. I mean, if you're in the swimming bath and someone sort of down the deep end.
Yeah, you can
make an
oyster
here, like next to you.
Yeah.
And I think things like that just make an edge, but definitely using that different pop-up, that's caught me loads of carp.
Well, that's a few brilliant edges there from Lee. I'm sure over the next sort of year or so on the TV station, we're going to bring you more from Lee, but that's the one he's been currently using and nailing loads of fish.
Yeah.
And
cheers, Dave.
Long may it continue, mate.
Yeah, cheers, mate.